page if you're using the book, otherwise it'll be on the screen. 465, what a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. First two verses, 465 this time. Singing 465 is our next. When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still and with all who will trust and obey. 467, first two verses as we sing. Is on the same page there, 468. I have heard my Saviour calling, I have heard my Saviour calling, take thy cross and follow me. 468, first two verses, please.
Where he lives, the I will follow. Where he lives, the I will follow.
That's a beautiful hymn. You seemed a little unsure of it there at the start, but I think we got the thought and the message that the hymn writer intended us to get. 474 over the page, for those of you who are following the book. 474, days are filled with sorrow and care. Hearts are lonely and drear. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near.
So much, Nigel, for leading the singing up until this point. We're going to stand together this time, please, as we continue to worship the Lord. This time it's hymn number 331. 331, standing as we sing. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace in the mansions bright and blessed. He'll prepare for us a place. 331, and we're standing, please, as we sing.
Mansions, bright and blessed, he'll prepare.
sing that first verse and chorus again, please, just as you keep your seats. Lovely to have the Reverend Ian Brown with us tonight and his wife. And we'll ask Mr. Brown, please, to come to the pulpit and open the meeting in prayer, if that's okay, just as we sing the first verse and chorus again.
Together in prayer, please. Our gracious and heavenly Father, we thank thee that we're found together in thy presence here on a Sabbath evening, that we can come with notes of victory and joy and thanksgiving, because we're not fighting on the losing side, but rather we are on the side of triumph, and we're moving on to ultimate victory. And so we pray that as we assemble here and as we acknowledge thee in thy persons as God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, we pray for thy presence especially in this meeting. We thank thee, Lord, for way back in eternity past, how the Lord, God the Father, has planned everything. And it has all worked out from that time on till now, right through every eon of history. It has worked out according to thy plan and thy purpose. And Lord, what a wonder it is to be caught up in the middle of the purpose of God and to know that thou hast an individual purpose and a personal plan for all of our lives. But Father, we thank thee that that ultimate plan was that Christ the Redeemer could come and make atonement for the sins of the people, that on Calvary he would die to redeem. We praise thee that the Lord Jesus, without hesitation, in fact, we read in the book of the Psalms how he declares, "Lo, I come, in the volume of the book it is written of me, I delight to do thy will, O my God, yea, thy law is within my heart." We thank thee that he spared nothing all of the way. As a hymn writer put it, all the way to Calvary, he went for me, he died to set me free. We thank thee, Lord, there was not a misstep, there was nothing accidental about the path to the cross. We praise thee how our Saviour said that I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how am I straitened until it be accomplished. We thank thee that he set his face as a flint to go to Jerusalem, that there was that holy determination that the price of atonement would be paid. That he that John healed as, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world," that he would come and give his life as a ransom for many, and open the life gate that all of his people may go in. We thank thee, Lord, for the guarantee that the work was done and well done, and done to the satisfaction of all in heaven. Whenever that receipt came fluttering down from the glory and touched earth with the tomb that was now open, the stone that is rolled back, and the Saviour risen from the dead, manifesting himself to all of those witnesses in the one place and many others in different places, proving that the work of atonement had been finished, the devil had been defeated, sin had been defeated as well, the grave had been triumphed over, and we praise thee that because he lives, then we shall live also. We pray as well tonight that as we assemble here, we will know not only the benefits that were accomplished on Calvary, but we pray that every benefit there that was paid for in full by atoning blood will be applied further onto our hearts and our minds and consciences by God the Holy Spirit. And it is thy presence that we need. We know that thou hast come into the world with one mission, and that is to focus eyes and minds upon the man of Calvary. We thank thee your Saviour was able to say that he shall take of mine and shall show it unto thee. And so we pray that thy blessed Holy Spirit will come into our meeting tonight in a real and in a precious and in a powerful way, that it will take the word that will be preached, and thou wilt apply it with grace and mercy unto many a heart. And if there be those here who are unconverted, we pray that while that may be the way in which they have come into the building, that they will not go out the same way, but rather will be changed by the almighty and amazing grace of God. So we pray for the power of God to fall upon our brother tonight as he stands behind this desk, as he preaches the word of life, as he presents the one and the only answer to all the ills of our society, the brokenness of our cities, our towns and our villages. And Lord, we pray that even as the message is taken by this church down to the former Burnhouse site in weeks that are to come, the double cause, the grace of heaven to fall there, the showers of blessing to descend upon that site night by night, the preaching of the gospel to be anointed by thy power, and may many sinners be swept into the kingdom of thy love and thy mercy. Come and answer prayer. Do us good tonight, and may we enjoy thy presence and be able to say as we leave, it was good for us to have been in the house of God tonight. We wouldn't have missed it because we met in a special way with the Lord our God. Do it for thy glory and for thy blessed name's sake. We ask it for Jesus' honor. Amen.
Thank you so much, brother, for opening the meeting in prayer. We really appreciate that. And can we give each and every one of you tonight a warm and a sincere word of welcome? We really appreciate your presence with us. Nice to have one or two visitors, and you're especially welcomed if this is your first night with us, or maybe the first night for a little while. Lovely to have Joan Rutherford with us again this evening, and welcome you in the Saviour's name. And you trust that you'll take our greetings back to the folk there in Port Erin. I'm going to ask Mr. Graham now, please, to come and to bring the announcements for the incoming week.
Yes, we reiterate those words of welcome from Reverend Higginson to each and every one of you as you join with us tonight. We welcome you in the Saviour's name. And it is good to have visitors with us. We thank the Reverend Brown for opening in prayer, and we welcome him and his wife to our service this evening. Immediately after our service this evening, we're going to take a 10-minute comfort break. And then we would like as many as possible to reassemble in the Douglas Suite. And we'd like to give a time over to pray that God will bless our forthcoming mission. It's going to be held on the old Burnhouse site. It's a tent, gospel tent mission. And we would like you to come and to pray for it. It's running through from, I'm what off my script now, and I haven't got the, yes, here it is. It's going to be held from the 4th to the 16th of September. And our Sunday night services are going to be held in the tent. So that's a new thing for you indeed. But I'd like you to come and to pray. We'd like as many as possible to take part in prayer. And we're praying with one focus, and that is that God will come and bless that gospel mission and undertake for a servant as he preaches. So we'll leave that invitation open to you. I'd like to thank all who came along this afternoon in response for outreach workers. It is really encouraging to see so many young people along, and our hearts were encouraged at the numbers who came, so thank you very much for that. Tomorrow night, being our congregational prayer meeting, the will of God, it will be conducted by the Reverend Higginson, and we'll be having a special focus again on the forthcoming gospel mission. 9:15 on Tuesday morning, anyone who can attend the church to distribute invitations to your gospel mission will be very welcome. Your help will be very much appreciated. Some 1,500 invitations were distributed last Tuesday morning, and we thank all those workers for their enthusiasm and for their help week after week. 7 o'clock on Wednesday morning, early morning prayer meeting, will indeed again be set aside for the gospel mission. If you can come at that time, or indeed any of the special times this week, please set aside one time that suits you to come and to seek the face of the Lord. Friday night at 8 o'clock, we're having a special Friday night prayer meeting, and we'd ask you to come along there and uphold the Lord's servant and the gospel mission before the throne of grace. Next Lord's Day, usual service times, 11:30 and 7, and the will of God, the Reverend Higgins will be along to preach God's word. A summer Bible club for children ages 4 to 11 will be held in McGebbery Community Centre, commencing tomorrow night through to Friday night. And please pray for these meetings and for Brother Phil Harden and those who are going to assist him, and for the workers there in McGebbery. Pray that the children in McGebbery will be reached, that they'll hear the gospel, and that God will be merciful to them in their young and tender age. Please remember Miss Elizabeth Edwards as she conducts a summer Bible club this week in Carrickfergus. Also her brother Chris Kilne, who's conducting a children's Bible club in Port Glenone. Remember them in your prayers. Then all young people, senior youth fellowship age, are welcome to go along on Friday night, the 2nd of September, with a trip to Leggan Adventure, where they will be using the hydro bikes on the River Leggan. The minibus will leave the church car park at 6:15 sharp, and there's a subsidised cost of £5 per person, and they will be visiting McDonald's afterwards. This is the resumption of the Senior Youth Fellowship, Friday night, the 2nd of September. All young people, senior youth fellowship age, are very welcome. Indeed, it's an opportunity for you to get to know other young people in the church. Then we're thankful that the Reverend Malcolm Patterson and his wife have returned to Kenya safely this week. Please remember them in your prayers. Thank you for the attention, Leonard.
Thank our brother so much for bringing the announcements for the incoming week, and we trust that God will bless the mission in McGabbery amongst the boys and girls. Do pray for that. Even if you're not directly involved, you can be praying every evening or even every morning in your devotions and quiet times that the Lord will bless the word of God as it goes forth amongst the children. And then please begin to pray as well much for the tent mission. It's not going to be that far away now. Two Lord's Day evenings will be, God willing, in the tent, and we trust that God will visit us in these dark days that we're living in, days that we desperately need a move of the Spirit of the living God. And our chief desire is that the Savior will be exalted and uplifted, that he will be glorified, that souls might be drawn out after him, that lives might be changed, and even homes and families by the power of the gospel. So let's really get behind this. Who knows what the future holds? Who knows how short our time is? And we want to make this a real drive to get people in under the sound of God's precious word. So will you pray much and invite your friends and loved ones in, and let's really endeavor to go through with God in the weeks that lie ahead. Let's sing another hymn together, please. Just as the offering is received, you're maybe not able to give or prepared to give tonight, just let the plate pass you on by. We're going to sing these words as we remain seated, 526. I have only one life on this earth, and this vapor, it's passing away. I must labor for treasures of worth ere toil ends the close of the day.
There's no end to the close of the day.
please, the third and final verse and the chorus. Let's stand as we sing. I invite you, please, tonight to turn in your Bibles to Luke's Gospel and chapter 12. Luke chapter 12, we're reading from verse 16. Luke chapter 12 and verse number 16, just down to verse 21, so a short reading tonight, Luke chapter 12, 16 to 21. Over the last while, we've been thinking about some of the great stories that our Savior told. And here we are tonight with what we often call the parable of the rich fool. The parable of the rich fool. Verse 16 of Luke's Gospel and chapter 12. Luke 12. And verse 16, and he spake a parable unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my fruits. And he said, this will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say unto my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. And we know the Lord will bless this very solemn portion of his own precious and inspired word. Let's pray together, please, and just ask the Lord to be with us. Let's pray earnestly that God's Spirit will move. Let's pray. Father, we thank thee tonight for our wonderful Savior. We thank thee for that name that is above every name. We thank thee for the preaching ministry of our Lord. We thank thee for his work upon the cross. We thank thee for his glorious resurrection. We thank thee for his ascension into glory. We praise thee for the promise of the Holy Spirit, that thou shalt receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me. Loving God and everlasting Father, we ask, O God, that thou wilt fill this meeting house with thy presence. And grant, O God, tonight that every distracting thought and every thing that would divert us and draw us away from the word of God might be taken from our thoughts. Father, we need thee so much. And we pray tonight, Lord God, that thou wilt be pleased, O God, to bind the strong man. We realize, O God, that the enemy is so active and so busy, especially in these closing days of time. And Lord, tonight we submit ourselves afresh to thee. We resist the devil in the Savior's name. We pray, Lord God, for the covering of the precious blood. We ask, O God, that thou wilt magnify and exalt thy Son. Grant even now great liberty as the word of God goes forth. Lord, stir up our hearts to labor for treasures of worth and to invest our lives in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Because, Lord God, we know not what a day may bring forth, and ultimately all roads lead to the judgment. And, Lord, we want to hear those words, someday, well done, good and faithful servant. Lord, remember perhaps even one here this evening, or maybe more, that do not know thee. O God, I pray that the Spirit of God will work in hearts, and that thou wilt bring precious souls to Christ and to the cross, and grant that the Son of God will be exalted. We ask these things for thy glory, giving thanks in his precious and worthy name. Amen. In this day and generation that we are living in, there are so many that seem to treat life like a game, almost like a game of Monopoly, which the goal in life is to accumulate as much wealth and as many material possessions as possible, live life in the fast lane, and then ultimately the goal in life is retirement and the accumulation of wealth and the accumulation of goods and possessions, and to live in as big a house as possible, to have as much money in the bank as possible, to have as much property as possible. And for many, that is the goal and that is the idea of success. And successful living and a successful life for many is measured by what we have by way of material possessions. The sad reality is that lives and families have been destroyed and even ripped apart by such thinking. Here in Luke's Gospel, chapter 12, we read in the very opening verse, in the meantime, when there were gathered together an innumerable multitude of people, insomuch that they trod one upon another, he began to say unto his disciples, first of all, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. And so this enormous crowd of people are gathering together to listen to the Son of God preach the word of God. It describes this multitude as being an innumerable multitude. Just very difficult to put an exact figure upon how many people were coming that day to listen to the Savior preach and declare the word of God. And then we read these words in verse number 13. And one of the company, one individual, steps out from this exceeding great crowd of people and comes up to the Savior and says, Master, speak unto my brother that he divide the inheritance with me. Here's an individual. It's evident that the father figure in the home has passed away. An inheritance has been left behind. And somewhere along the line, a dispute has arisen about the father's will. And it's all about money. It's all about property. It's all about material possessions. And he sees, as he listens to the Son of God preach, here's a man with tremendous influence. Here's a man with great wisdom. Here's a man that should know what to do. And he asks the Savior to try to sort out this dispute concerning a will. And it's interesting that the Son of God desires to have nothing at all to do with it. He says in verse number 14, Man, who made me a judge or a divider over you? And he takes this instance and then he begins to apply it to others and says in verse number 15, Take heed and beware of covetousness. For a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesses. And he outlines and highlights this very dangerous sin of covetousness. Now, covetousness is one of those sins that is very easily covered up. And it's also one of those sins that is very easily overlooked. It is one of those sins that is very easily undermined, and yet it's one of the most dangerous sins of all. The 10th commandment says, Thou shalt not covet. Now, we all tonight know that it's wrong to steal. We all tonight know that it's wrong to commit adultery. We all tonight know that it's wrong to commit murder. But somehow, the sin of covetousness in the eyes of men so easily goes under the radar. If you were guilty of murder, I suppose most people would know about it. If you were guilty of adultery, most people would know about it. If you'd been guilty of theft, many people would find out about it. But this sin of covetousness is a sin of the heart. So often it's a sin that only God sees. And yet it's a sin that destroys lives as much as any other sin. It's a sin that robs people of happiness. It's a sin that can so easily result in many other sins. It's a sin that can destroy homes and families and marriages and relationships. And it's also, of course, a sin against God, because covetousness is a sin that refuses to be content with the things that we have. Covetousness is the inordinate desire for things that God in His mercy has seen fit to withhold from us. Covetousness is that sin that somehow feels we can fill our souls and get happiness and joy and peace and satisfaction with material possessions. And the Lord, so many times in His earthly ministry, by parable, by direct teaching, warns about the danger and the sin of covetousness. And then He launches in verse number 16 to this great parable. And it's again a parable that highlights the sin of covetousness. Now, the Apostle Paul, before his great conversion, boasted in his great ability to keep the law. He said, as touching the law, he was blameless. And as Paul went through the law of God and through the law of the Jewish people, it seemed that somehow he ticked all of the boxes. But then in Romans chapter 7, he shows that whenever it came to this commandment concerning covetousness, that Paul, in his heart of hearts, was a very covetous, a very materialistic person who lusted after so many things. And yet that sin of covetousness was so easily covered up. Now, we often call this parable the parable of the rich fool. And everything for this man that the Savior speaks about in this parable, everything seems to be going so well, until suddenly, in verse 20, God steps in. And God addresses this man as a fool and says to him, "Thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee." And it's as if God says, right, that's it. Game over. Time's up. You've reached the end of the road, you've reached the end of life's journey, and now it's time to go out into eternity and to meet God. And it's as if God is saying to this man, game over. Now, if God was to say to you those same words tonight that He said to this rich fool, I wonder where that would leave you. Here's a man who never thought about eternity. Here's a man who never brought God into his life. Here's a man who never factored anything spiritual into his decision-making processes in life. Here's a man who only lived for self, who only lived for time, who didn't live with eternity's values in view, and then suddenly God says, game over. This night, thy soul shall be required of thee. And I want to challenge you, and I want to ask you, if God was to say to you tonight, game over, if God was to call you tonight from time into eternity, and God was to say, this is the very night, this is the very hour, this is the very evening that I am going to bring you from time into eternity, I wonder where that would leave you. This man had so much of this world's possessions. And yet the tragedy was he was a spiritual pauper before God. You know, tonight as we think about the parable of the rich fool, there are three words that come to mind as I think about this individual. The word affluence, the word ambition, and then also the word accountability. Affluence, ambition, and accountability. Verses 16 and 17 speak of his affluence. You'll notice that this man was materially affluent. The ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully, And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my fruits. He was rich. He was prosperous. He wanted for nothing. He was materially affluent. Now tonight, there's nothing wrong with affluence. There's nothing wrong with being successful in life. There's nothing wrong with prosperity. There's nothing wrong with material riches. There's absolutely nothing wrong with those things at all. Many good and godly men and women in Scripture were blessed materially. Many men in the Word of God were blessed with success financially. And so it is down through the history of the world. There have been many wealthy people who have honored God with their substance, who have been blessed by God in a financial realm. And they have honored God and they have put God first and God has blessed them. And they haven't allowed their prosperity or their affluence to dull their spiritual senses. And they haven't made an idol of the prosperity that they have enjoyed in life. But this individual was not such a person. The Bible never condemns wealth. But the Word of God does condemn covetousness. In fact, the Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 10 that the love of money is the root of all evil. Not money, not finance, not material possessions, not prosperity, but the love of money, the desire for more money, covetousness is the root of all evil. And we look at our world tonight, and so much of the strife and contention and problems internationally, nationally, locally, and within homes and within families, between siblings and between spouses and parents and their children, so much strife and so much division and so much disunity and so much carnality is caused by this awful sin of covetousness, the love of money. There's nothing wrong with riches in the right place. Somebody once said that money is a very good servant, but a very poor master. And it seems to me tonight that this individual that the Savior is speaking about has made wealth and prosperity and money his God and his master. And he is living for those things and for those things alone. There is nothing wrong with wealth in its right place. But we need to remind ourselves that here's a man who neither honored God with his riches nor thanked God for them. In just 2.5 verses, we have somewhere in the region of 11 personal pronouns that this man uses. He says in verse number 17, he thought within himself, what shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my goods. And he said, this will I do. I will bring down my barns and build greater, and there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods, and I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. So many personal pronouns. He's consumed with me. He's consumed with self. It's all about me, myself, and I. No thought about anybody else. Certainly no thought about God and his thinking. He's not thinking, now how can I use the things that God has blessed me with to further the kingdom of God? How can I honor God with my substance? How can I use my life and my gifts and my talents and my abilities and my prosperity to uplift and to magnify the Son of God? How can I use the things that God has blessed me with to help others? He has no thought of those things at all. All this individual is thinking about is himself. Self-loving, self-idolatry, self-enthroned. No thought about his neighbor. No thought at all about his creator. And beloved, tonight, isn't that perhaps one of the cardinal characteristics of modern-day society here in Britain or in Northern Ireland? So many are consumed with self. You know, the middle letter in the word sin is the letter I. The middle letter in the name Lucifer is the letter I. The middle letter in the word pride is the letter I. And whenever I am in the center of my universe, it's all about I, it's all about me, it's all about self, that's where all of the problems start. The Bible says, only by pride cometh contention. And we hear so much nowadays in our streets and in media about pride. And it's really all about self. Sadly, even many professing Christians are living for self rather than living for God. What makes me happy? What do I want out of life? What do I want to achieve? How can I prosper my way? How can I better myself? How can I put myself in front of others? How can I do better than my neighbor? How can I accumulate more? How can I spend my spare time? What can I do with everything that I've achieved in life? And it's all about self. It's all about me. It's all about I. And it's just like this man here who didn't take his place as a Christian at all. But the sad truth is that many professing Christians are consumed completely with self. And this man acts as if he has done it all. The scripture says here that the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. He had been blessed under God with prosperous ground. He didn't create the soil. He didn't create the nutrients. He didn't cause the rain to fall upon his ground. He wasn't able to cause the seed to germinate. He wasn't able to cause the seed to take root. He wasn't able to cause the seed to grow or to bring forth fruit. Everything that this individual had and the means by which he prospered were entirely outside of himself. But he never once thought to give God the glory. And again, isn't that just like this modern society, this modern world that we live in? Do we take time every day to thank God for how he's blessed us? Do we take time every day to thank God for how he's prospered us? Do we ever sit down and thank God for the rain that falls, for the food that we enjoy, for how God has blessed us? Do we grumble rather than complain that we don't have enough and we're always looking for more? And isn't it true tonight, and I'm guilty of it myself, all of the rising costs of fuel and food and rising living costs, we take them so ill. But do we ever stop to thank God for the very fact that we never go to bed hungry? Whenever we were prosperous, whenever things were so easily affordable, do we ever thank God for those things? There are multitudes tonight that go to their beds hungry, thirsty. Some don't even have a bed to sleep in. Many don't have a roof over their heads. Many people are suffering intense pain and sickness, illness, and they've no health service like the one we have. And yet we grumble and we complain and we're so ungrateful at times. Just like this individual here, never lifts his heart to thank God for all of the things that God has given him richly to enjoy. And God warned the children of Israel away back there in Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse number 18. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant which he sware unto thy fathers, as it is this day. It is God Almighty that gives us the ability to be prosperous. And yet so rare it is for people to thank God publicly and to thank the Lord even privately for how God has richly blessed us. Riches, furthermore, are temporal. We cannot bring them with us. Job described himself as coming out of the womb naked. And he says, I'll leave this world naked as well. We brought nothing into this world. And we can take nothing out of this world. The Lord gives. And the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You know, the old Jews used to have a proverb that whenever a little child is born into this world, that child is born and it comes out of the womb and immediately the little fists are clenched. And it just gives the idea, the illustration that as we're born into this world, we're always trying to accumulate more and more and more and hold on to things. But the Jews also said that whenever a man or a woman dies, their hands are open. We're born into this world with a covetous heart, but we leave this world with absolutely nothing of the possessions we accumulate. Do you ever walk around a cemetery, maybe attending a funeral service, and just as you're walking to the burial ground of a friend or a loved one, do you ever just look at some of the headstones? I think it's such a remarkable thing in this day and age in which we're living. You know, I was in Blair's Cemetery recently, and we looked at some of the headstones, and it was quite remarkable just how many young people were marked by those headstones. So many teenagers, so many young men in their mid to late 20s, so many in their 30s and 40s. In fact, it was quite a high percentage of people under the age of 70 who were marked by those headstones. And yet, on so many of them, you had little emblems of football teams or loyal orders or whatever it may have been, little emblems to show this is what they loved and this is what they lived for. And yet the reality is all of those things are temporal. And the Apostle Paul says we're not to focus or live for things that are temporal, but rather to think about those things that are eternal, those things that are invisible. Because the things that are temporal, they'll fade away and we'll never take them with us. But there's an eternal God, and you've got an eternal soul. And the Bible speaks about an eternal salvation, an eternal heaven, and an eternal hell. Furthermore, riches do not satisfy. Here's a man that it seems that whatever he got in life, he always wanted so much more. In fact, he had done so well for himself that the barns that he had were no longer big enough to hold all the goods and all of the fruits and all of the produce that he had made. Barn after barn after barn. And he says, I'm going to tear them all down and I'm going to build bigger barns and greater barns because I want so much more. And again, how many there are just like that. You know, shortly after the national lottery started, I remember one of the individuals who won the largest jackpot at that particular time. I'm not sure what it was, 12 or 13 million. He was interviewed by the local press, and they asked him, now that you've won the lottery, you've won something like 12, 13 million, what do you want to do now? You know what he said? He says, I'd like to win it again. I'd like to win it again. Wasn't enough. And I thought to myself, what a loser. Thinks he's a winner, but really it's not enough. I want more and more and more. Wealth can never satisfy. In fact, all of a sudden, this man seems as he's now fallen in good times as he thinks. He's now more worried and more anxious than ever. He says in verse number 17, he thought within himself. And the idea behind the word thought there, all of a sudden, he's anxious. I've done well for myself. My ground has yielded so much produce. And now I've got this awful problem. I don't know where to hold it all. And I don't know what to do with it. How can I keep all this stuff? How can I stop others from getting their hands on it? How can I hide it away from the rest of the world? How can I keep it all safe? What shall I do? Isn't that an amazing question? What shall I do? You know, whenever Peter was preaching in Acts chapter 2 in the day of Pentecost, and he called the people to account, and he reminded them of their sin, and he preached about Christ, they asked that same question. Men and brethren, what shall we do? And they were now thinking about spiritual things. The jailer at Philippi asked that same question. What shall I do to be saved? He was thinking now about eternity, thinking about his soul. And maybe tonight those are the types of questions that you need to be asking. What shall I do about my sin? What shall I do about my soul? What shall I do about my Savior? What shall I do about this salvation? But this man's not thinking in those lines at all. He's thinking, what shall I do about all of these goods? But the tragedy was, while he was materially affluent, he was spiritually bankrupt. The Son of God says in verse 21, as he brings it all to a conclusion and summary, so is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. No thought of God, no thought of his eternal soul, no thought of eternity, spiritually bankrupt, didn't realize, and maybe you've never realized, that you are a debtor before God. God has given you life. You're fearfully and wonderfully made. And every good and perfect gift cometh from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there is neither variableness nor shadow of turning. And you're not investing in eternity. We thought last Lord's Day evening about how God has given so many various degrees of talent. And maybe tonight your talents are buried. You're not living in light of God's eternity. And furthermore, you're a debtor before God because of your sin. And you've got absolutely no credit in heaven. And yet in a worldly sense, you're perhaps like this man here, marked by affluence. Not only is there affluence here, but there's also ambition. Verse number 18, having thought about this awful quandary that he seems to have, what shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my goods. Verses 18 and 19, he evidently comes up with some sort of solution. He's spent time thinking. Maybe he's been asking other people for advice. What do you think I should do? But it seems somehow that he's kept all of these thoughts to himself. And whenever he comes to a solution, he doesn't think, well, God has blessed me. God has prospered me. I'm going to honor God with my tithe or with the first fruits of my labor. Or I'm going to help my family. Or I'm going to help my neighbor. Or I'm going to undertake to bless those who are poor and less fortunate than myself. I have so much and I can spare so much. He doesn't think about those things at all. He just thinks about building bigger and better and laying up for himself treasures upon the earth. Thinking about the future, the few years that lie ahead, but absolutely no thought at all about eternity. And as we think about this man's ambition, he's ambitious, I believe, on three levels. He's ambitious regarding his industry. He says to himself, this will I do, verse 18, I will pull down my barns and I will build greater and there I will bestow all my fruits and my goods. It's like he's saying, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go flat out for the next number of months and years. I'm going to work as hard as I possibly can. I'm going to build up my empire. And I'm going to accumulate as much wealth as possible. I'm going to pull down, see all these barns that you see around my house here? I'm going to pull them all down and I'm going to build bigger. I'm then going to build greater. I'm going to fill them to capacity. I'm going to make sure that I have enough. And then I'm going to sit back. And I'm going to enjoy all of my labors. Now, ambition can be a good thing. If it's channeled in the right direction. But here's a man whose sole concern is to build up his business, to build up his empire, to accumulate more and more property. Now, the Bible does not condemn us for thinking about the future. The Bible does not condemn anybody for planning for retirement or whatever it might be. But here's a man who is purely and only thinking about himself. Gratifying his own desires. No ambition at all for things spiritual. And as we have said, this seems somehow now to be a problem even with professing Christians. Industry for a short while. And then after that, idleness. Once I have done this, I will say in verse number 19, I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. He doesn't realize that he's not to boast of tomorrow. He's just got this idea that I'm fit, I'm well, I'm healthy. I've got everything that I need and I can live off it for many, many years. There's much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. Just kick up your feet. Live for self. Do absolutely nothing. Other than eat as much as you can, drink as much as you like, and just live your life in revelry, frivolity, and amusement, and merriment, and live solely for yourself. You know, all that's gone on, I believe, in the last couple of years, the last 2.5 years, has really shown what is in the hearts of so many people. You know, at the beginning of all of the confusion and all of the pandemic and whatever side you take in the spectrum of opinion, many people at the start of it all had the idea, this will bring people to God. This will cause people to think about eternity. This will cause people to think about spiritual things. This will cause people to realize how frail life is and how uncertain things are. And it hasn't even caused the Christians to think about spiritual things, to think about eternal things, to think about living in light of eternity and living for the glory of God. It seems to have had the opposite effect, that we think, well, time is so uncertain now. We could go into lockdown again. We're not sure what a day may bring forth. Let's enjoy ourselves as much as we possibly can. Let's spend our money upon ourselves. Let's eat. Let's drink. Let's be merry. Just like the Epicureans that we read about there in Corinthians. And they just had the idea, let us eat, let us drink, because tomorrow we might die. This man wasn't even thinking about that. He was thinking, let's eat, let's drink, and be merry. I don't think I'm going to die tomorrow. I think I've got many years left. But he's just thinking again and again and again about himself. I'm just going to be idle. I'm going to do nothing. Now, everybody likes a week or two's holiday. There's nothing at all wrong with that. The Lord said to his disciples, come ye apart and rest a while. It's good to have rest. It's good to have relaxation. It's good to have time with your family or time on your own and time with your hobbies. There's nothing wrong with those things. But the problem is whenever that becomes a lifestyle of idleness. Have you noticed the culture that we live in nowadays? You get people going to Super Value or Spa or Eurospar 3 o'clock in the afternoon. They're still in their pajamas. They're going to the chip shop to go home to watch all of their favorite soap operas on their plasma screen TVs. And they call that living. And that's the goal that many people have. Do as little as it is possible to do. Sit back. Kick up your feet. Do absolutely nothing. Eat, drink, and be merry. Industry for a little while. Then idleness. And then after that, indulgence. Eat, drink, be merry. Fill your belly with as much as you can. Enjoy all of this world's goods. Don't think about eternity. Don't think about the soul. Don't think about God. Don't think about others. Think about yourself and yourself alone. Self enthroned. That's all this individual's thinking about. Philippians chapter 3, 19 speaks about those people whose God is their belly. This man's not thinking about restraints. This man's not thinking about discipline. There's no self-denial here. It's just eat as much as you can, as often as you can, whatever you can. Do the same with drink. Drink whatever you can. And just sit back and enjoy yourself. And don't let anybody in to spoil your little world. It's all about you. And I tell you, that is the philosophy of this world. I think it was Aleister Crowley or Anton LaVey, one of those occultists, and they said, do as thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. And that was their principal tenet of Satanism. Do as thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. And yet that's the ideology of the world. Do whatever you like. Live whatever way you please. Don't let anybody question it. Indulge yourself in immorality, in sexual immorality, in drunkenness, drug abuse, gluttony, amusement, pleasure, and that's all that there is to life. As long as you're not harming anybody else, just indulge. And one of the great problems is it leaves people empty, dissatisfied, dejected, depressed, unhappy. It fuels that materialistic, covetous consumer ideology that if I had just a little bit more, I'd be happy. Always looking for the next thing. And I believe that in part is why there's an avalanche of sexual immorality in our province today. Wasn't enough to open the floodgates outside of marriage and to sleep around in the 60s and have the just free love and whatever it is. Adultery and fornication and pornography, it's not enough. We need now to experiment with homosexuality and transgenderism. And it's just the same ideology. All about self. No restraints. And yet, perhaps, if we're honest, even in evangelical circles, we're a lot closer to the principles of the city of Sodom than we care to think. You know, one of the Lord's accusations, if we could call it that, with the city of Jerusalem is found in Ezekiel chapter 16 and verse number 49, where God says to Jerusalem, the joy of the whole earth, beautiful for situation, the city of our God, this was the iniquity of thy sister Sodom. He says, Sodom, in my eyes, is like your sister. He looks at the city of Jerusalem at that particular time in Ezekiel's day and says, it's as if you're cut from exactly the same cloth, born of the same blood. This was the iniquity of thy sister Sodom. And he doesn't mention the sexual impurity and the sexual immorality. He says, this was the iniquity of thy sister Sodom, pride, fullness of bread, and abundance of idleness. Isn't it amazing there that you have it in Ezekiel 16, 49, Sodom and pride, the two words together. And that has become a movement now in the 21st century that's embraced and endorsed by so many in high realms of society. But the Lord says, here's the problem. In Sodom and now in Jerusalem amongst my people, pride. Self, in other words. Fullness of bread, an abundance of food, gluttony it is, and abundance of idleness. This man was ambitious, just like the modern man, but no ambition to be holy, no ambition to be godly, no ambition to be spiritual, no ambition to live to the glory of God. No ambition or desire to live for the good of his fellow man. No desire to be a good citizen. No desire to be a good husband or a good father or a good brother or a good neighbor. His ambitions were solely selfish. Now, this man wasn't, as far as we know, an alcoholic, a jailbird, or a junkie. In the eyes of the world, he's a glowing success story. Affluent. And ambitious. Everything that the world tells us we have to be. But one thing he forgot. He was accountable. Verse number 20. After he has made all of these boasts and all of these plans, but. Verse 20. But God. Do you ever read in Scripture how often we have that little phrase there? But God. Here it is with a man who doesn't see his need and is puffed up with pride, but God is going to bring him low. In Romans chapter 5, we have words of encouragement for those who feel that they're lost in sin, but God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. But here's a man who doesn't feel his need for atonement. Here's a man who doesn't feel his need for forgiveness. Here's a man who doesn't feel his need for repentance, and he's boasting in all the things that he has done, is doing, and ultimately thinks will do. But God. But God said unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. What an awful thing. Here we see highlighted his folly. God says, you're a fool. I can't think of anything more fearful than that. Than for God Almighty to address an individual personally and say you're a fool. So foolish to be taken up with time. You know, people build the hopes nowadays and build houses that they have the idea they're going to live in them forever. I know a brother in the Lord, and at one time he was a car salesman. And he said one time he had a very unusual experience. He's working in a large car warehouse, and his boss came to him and says, "Listen, there's a customer that's dealt with us for years. I need you to go to his home. He wants to buy a car." And so this dear brother in the Lord went to that home, found the address. Man's daughter led him in the house, and he went upstairs, and there's this man, and he's dying. He's terminally ill. He's only got a few months to live, and he knows it full well. And all he can think about at that stage in life is changing the car. The car that he'll never even drive again, sitting out in the forecourt of his house. It's depreciating in value. And all he can think about, I need to change that car and get a good deal on it. And he's never going to drive the new car. He says it was the most amazing thing. Here's a man that's dying, and he's going out into eternity, and he's got no thought of God, no thought about his soul, no thought about heaven, no thought about his past. All he can think about is the present, changing some stupid car. His folly, his forgetfulness. It seems that the rich fool here never stopped to think about God, never thought to think about his soul, so taken up with time. The Word of God calls us, remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth. And I'm sure many people my age and above, you can think about young people that you ran about with, went to school with, Sunday school with, children's meetings with, youth organizations with. And they went along to all of the same organizations you went to, and maybe even thought or talked about the things of God, and talked about salvation, and maybe talked about being a Christian. And then they made friendships and relationships, and they got into employment, and they got caught up with life itself. And if you were to meet them tonight, no thought at all about the things of God. I tell you, I could take you to dozens of people like that this evening. They fail to remember their Creator. They got out of their youth, they got out of their teens and out of their 20s, never really thinking about the reality of a Creator. We are called in the Bible to remember our Creator, and there's a day coming whenever we will remember. Luke chapter 16 and verse number 25, Abraham says to the rich man who has died and been buried and lifted up his eyes in hell, being in torments, and Abraham said, "Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivedst good things." And I believe that this rich fool here was going to hear the same words himself. Remember in your lifetime all the good things that you received. Did you ever think about who gave them to you? Did you ever think about where they came from? You never stopped to remember and thank God and give God the glory. His folly, his forgetfulness. And then ultimately his fate. This night, thy soul shall be required of thee. You know, I believe as we look at this man tonight, he must have been, in his own thinking, a relatively young man, because he says, "You have much goods laid up, not just for a few years, but much goods laid up for many years." Maybe he was just in his late 30s. Maybe in his 40s, maybe to stretch in his 50s. But the Lord says this night, he says many years. The Lord says, no, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. You're going out tonight to meet God, he says. This very night. Herein, friends, lies the urgency of God's salvation. Whenever the Bible speaks about God's salvation, it's never in the future tense. It's always in the present tense. Now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. And God has appointed a time. The Bible says it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. You know, as I was thinking tonight about this message, I couldn't help but think about that dear man that stopped us one day, one Friday morning at our open-air meeting in Lisburn. I related the story a few weeks ago. I was just finishing off a short address in the open air. Brother Eric was giving out gospel tracts. I think Herbie was further down the street. And as I was just finishing off, I could hear this voice arguing. Sure, nobody's listening to him. Why would you stand and preach like that in the street? Nobody's even listening. And he got into this. He got so heated and so argumentative. And he just had no time at all for the things of God. And as I went over and we got talking, he says, my brother, he's one of you. He's like one of you preachers up there in the Coal Rain area, he said. And I said, did you say Coal Rain? I says, what church is he in? What's his name? And he mentioned his name. And I said, sure, he's a good friend of mine. He's a good fellow. He's a gospel preacher. I'm sure he shared the gospel with you many times. He says he has, but I've no interest. Dear friends, during our summer break, we met that dear brother up there in Coal Rain, had a time of fellowship with him. And I said to him, called him my name, and says, listen, I've got to know your brother. I meet him in Lisburn quite often. He said, did you not hear? Says about 2 months ago, he was found dead in his bed. Thought he'd many years to go. This night, thy soul shall be required of thee. It may be tonight that you've got a marginal reference Bible. If you have, just look at the reference there beside verse number 20 in your margin. Some reference Bibles have it, some don't. I know that Mr. Wesley, John Wesley, in his notes in the New Testament, can render the Greek phrase, this night thy soul shall be required of thee, can literally be rendered in this wise, thou fool, this night they shall require thy soul. This night they shall require thy soul. Did you ever read in Luke chapter 16 about the beggar that died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom? How comforting that is for the child of God to know that we never have to cross Jordan alone. God sends his holy angels to escort the souls of believers into the presence of Almighty God. He was carried by the angels into Abram's bosom. Beautiful expression. I believe tonight that the Word of God, it tells us that he's given his angels charge over us to keep us in all of our ways. And the Lord says that the angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him. The Bible speaks about God's holy angels being ministering spirits sent forth to minister unto those who shall be heirs of salvation. And friends, we can't see it tonight, but all around us there are principalities and there are powers and there are forces at work. And God has given his angels charge over us. And you can be absolutely sure and certain whenever you come to leave this world that God will send his angels to escort your soul into the presence of Jesus Christ, our Lord, in glory. But likewise, there are angels, according to this text of Scripture, that escort the souls of the lost out into a lost and undone eternity. This night thy soul shall be required of thee. And I'm going to send the death angel to escort your soul out there into eternity. And the Word of God says, dear friends, in Ecclesiastes chapter 8 and verse number 8, that there is no individual who has power over the Spirit to retain the Spirit, neither hath he power in the day of death. Death is whenever the soul evacuates and exits the body. And here's a man, and his body that night is going to fall to the earth. And his soul is going to be ushered out into the great eternity. And he's going to leave behind absolutely everything that he had in this world. And he will discover the truth of the Word of God when the Savior said, what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and yet lose his own soul? One human soul is worth more than all the wealth in the entire world. Seems that this man is going to pass away with a heart attack or an aneurysm or a coronary or maybe some terrible accident, and suddenly it's game over. And he's called from this world into the next. And in a few short days, the lawyers will be wrangling over his estate and over his fares like vultures over all that's left behind. And people will be standing at his open grave, paying maybe respects to his family. And then as soon as their backs are turned, I wonder who's going to get all those goods. I wonder who's going to get that fruitful plot of land. I wonder who's going to get all the fruit and all the produce and all the goods and all of the wealth and everything that has been left behind. The tragedy is not what he left behind. The tragedy is what lay before. No time to prepare. No time to repent. No time to get right with God. Can I ask you tonight, are you rich spiritually or are you poor? There's a lovely verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 9, and it says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, how that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be made rich." I tell you tonight, every born-again believer is richer than Bill Gates, richer than Elon Musk, richer than all of these tycoons that live in the face of the earth. A soul that's saved. A place in heaven that's secured. A Savior who's a treasure of worth. I tell you tonight, I've got everything that I need. Wouldn't it be a good thing for you to come to Christ tonight? Wouldn't it be a good thing for you to come to the cross tonight and get right with God and give your heart and life to him? Lest your soul should be required of you, and you're not ready. Let's have a word of prayer together. The meeting is over. Time has gone by so quickly. Let's pray and let's seek the Lord in closing. And if I can help you tonight or anybody else, just make that need known, and let's pray together. And if you're able to stay behind for prayer, we encourage you to do that, even if it's just for a few moments. Let's just wait upon the Lord, and let's call upon his name just now. And then we'll pray together as a congregation a little bit later. Heavenly Father, we realize tonight, Lord, that the things that this world of ours holds dear are so light and so vain and so shallow and so fleeting in light of the great eternity. And oh God, we pray tonight that you will help us to live for and to labor for and to love those things that really matter and that really count. Help us to put Christ first in all things. Help us to seek first his kingdom. Help us, Lord, to love God with all of our hearts, all of our souls, all of our mind and strength. Help us, Lord, to love our neighbors as ourselves. Help us, Lord, to labor for the souls of men. And grant, O God, that whenever we are called from time into eternity, that we'll hear those words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Lord, part us now and later on again with thy glory, with thy blessing, and for thy glory we pray. In Jesus' name.